But I guess my question is, what's so special about colorability? For example, you wear glasses.
Right.
I don't wear glasses.
Yes.
But we're both humans.
Yes.
So like, that one is three-colorable, and that one's not three-colorable, but that doesn't mean they're not the same species.
Right. So this begins a story, which is that there are, I would say, you know, in mathematics, we often try and answer a question by going more deeply into a subject. And I would say that this colorability test extracts from a deep mathematical subject, surprisingly deep about something as elementary look as not, properties that colorability happens to test, but the deeper properties would explain more fully. So from a deeper point of view, mathematicians know how to associate polynomials to knots. There are certain ways to get polynomial invariants of knots, as we call them, which are certain ways of computing from a knot a polynomial. The question of colorability of a knot is very curiously related to the question of these polynomials. And you can understand colorability better by developing the theory of polynomial invariants of knots. Specifically, there's an old polynomial invariant that goes back about 100 years called the Alexander polynomial. The polynomial invariant for this knot is just, so that usually delta is the notation for it. The polynomial in the variable x for this knot is just 1. The polynomial invariant for this knot turns out to be delta of x, the Alexander polynomial, is x squared minus x plus 1. And the one for this one is x squared minus 3x plus 1. And an amazing theorem, not so hard, but still amazing, is that a knot is p, let's say p is a prime to make life easier, a knot like 3 or 5, a knot is p colorable if and only if the Alexander polynomial, when you evaluate it at x equals minus 1, is divisible by p. Kind of surprising that there's a relationship between divisibility and colorability, but there is. This one has the polynomial x squared minus x plus 1. If I plug in x equals minus 1, you get plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, or plus 3. Aha! So this polynomial at minus, evaluated at minus 1, is plus 3, which is divisible exactly by 3, so this one turns out to be 3 colorable. This one, if I plug in x equals minus 1, turns out to be 1 minus minus 3 is plus 3, plus 1, that's 5. The polynomial evaluated at minus 1 is 5, and then it turns out that that means that it's colorable only by the factors of 5, so it's colorable by 5. So that's a deeper way to go, but that's a long story to explain how it's all in terms of polynomials. What I do want to add to this is a surprising late 20th century addition to this story, which is for a very long time, the Alexander polynomial was the natural polynomial invariant of knots. And then, quite surprisingly, it was discovered late in the 20th century that there are other polynomial invariants of knots with other nice properties that can be used to study them. There's a so-called Jones polynomial discovered by Vaughan Jones, almost a neighbor of yours since he's from New Zealand and you're from Australia. And then people combine these into polynomials and multivariables. So they have very good ways of distinguishing knots using deeper invariants than coloring. But coloring has the attraction that it happens to be a piece of this deep theory that surfaces up through all the machinery and that you can explicate in its own terms without introducing all the machinery, which is nice.
At the start, when you were showing me coloring,
yes,
was that just serving as kind of a proxy for this underlying polynomial invariance, or are the two things different?
Well, that's a good question, because one man's proxy or one man's idea is another man's step to a deeper idea, or another woman's step to a deeper idea. So can't say. I mean, it depends what you're trying to do. You know, and of course, anything we're doing may in turn be steps in the yet deeper program in mathematics. That's the way the subject unfolds. These polynomial invariants have other interpretations and other points of view and lead to many other deep ideas, some of which are still current research topics. So who can say?
Do you know why it's called an Alexander?
Yes, I do. It was named after a mathematician at Princeton named Alexander. I'm old enough to have known a lot of the early topologists. I knew Lefschetz, I knew Morse. Alexander, I did not know. He was sort of a recluse in his old age, and I didn't meet him. He was a descendant of a family that I think there's an Alexander on the Declaration of Independence. I think they were an old New Jersey family, and he devoted himself to this, and he discovered this polynomial invariant. Must have been around the 1920s, I would guess, when he discovered that. So it's got a story, it's got a long history to it. Knot theory goes back to the 19th century. Physicists became interested in studying knots. They had some ideas about whether or not studying knots might tell them something about basic particles. And at first, the knots were classified by eccentrics of various kinds, by Scottish divines who had nothing better to do with their time than to make tables of knots. And people wrote tables of knots. There's a standard table through nine crossings, and then people have, you with computer help, written much bigger tables, actually. Interestingly, on one of the standard tables of knots, there's a lawyer friend of mine, a retired lawyer here in New York, who's an amateur of knot theory, Ken Perko, and he discovered on one of the standard tables of knots a duplication. In other words, there were two different knots that could be actually deformed, that is, by Reitermeister moves, one into the other, with, I think, around 11 crossing knots, and people had mistakenly thought they were different. He found a duplication in the tables. Curious.
That's like, yeah, that's like finding a mistake in the Declaration of Independence or something.
Yes, kind yes, of like, yes. Right. It was kind of surprising, actually.
Had to rewrite all the books, did they?
Well, that book anyway, yes.
When I was a boy studying mathematics at school,
yes,
it would have been a real surprise to me that knots was such an important part of mathematics, such a rich field.
Well, I think that one of the advantages of teaching this to kids who are interested in math is it expands their notion of what mathematics can be about. They tend to think of mathematics as a linear set of subjects that they get in sequence, and here's something that comes from a totally different range of experience, but yet it ties in with things like polynomials and so on. So I think that it helps, it's kind of mind-blowing to see that possibility. I haven't even gotten around to discussing links, which is when you have two different circles that can be linked to each other, for example, and there is a corresponding classification theory for links. And that goes back to Gauss in the early 19th century. Gauss studied what we call the linking number, which is you have a link with two components, two circles in it. You can measure how many times one circle is going through the other circle, and that's an invariant of knots. That way, that's not the whole story about links, because there are links which are tied up even though their linking number is zero. Oh, here's a very pretty example, the Bromine rings. So there was a Bromio family in Italy in the Middle Ages, and they were banking family, and father had three sons, and they had this symbol to show why the sons should stick together in business. And the symbol was three circles. Those of us who live in New York remember this as Ballantine beer, because they had a beer and used a similar picture. To begin with, it looks like this. You have three circles, let's say, that overlap like that, right? So there's three circles like that. But now I'm going to make them into over under so that it's a projection of a link in three-dimensional space, in our usual space. And the way to do it, it's an example of what's called an alternating knot or alternating link. Each of these circles alternates going under over the other ones. And this happens to be a link or knot, in this case a link, which can be drawn alternatingly that way. Not all knots or links can, but this one is alternating. After you do that, what you'll notice is that each of these circles is unlinked when you remove the third one. This was the father's symbol of how the family should stick together. If one of them falls apart, the other two fall apart as well. So they all have to hang together. So that's called the Bromine rings, with that remarkable property. And then it's a nice mathematical exercise to try and prove that the Bromine rings are linked together. That's to say, you cannot, by continuous motions without cutting them, pull them apart, even though their linking numbers are zero. Count the total number of times each circle is going in and out of the other circles, you'll get zero. It's going in and then out. It's an interesting example of something where the mutual linking numbers are zero, and yet it cannot be pulled apart, which is kind of remarkable. And how can you prove it cannot be pulled apart? Well, there are very deep methods using what are called Massey products in algebraic topology and other methods. But again, rather miraculously, this simple trick of coloring works to pull it apart, to show that you cannot pull it apart, because you can check easily when you draw this. It's not three-colorable, so which means that it can't be pulled apart, because if it was, could be pulled apart, then you could color it by coloring the things you pulled to one side, say red, the other guy's blue, and that would be a three-coloration, because you'd have colored it with more than one color of the three colors. But you can't color it, and that means it can't be pulled apart. Now, again, you could ask, well, how explanative is that coloration proof? That's a question, and we could get into a nice philosophical discussion about what constitutes an explanative proof and what is a non-explanative proof. My friend Mark Steiner, who's a philosopher of mathematics at Hebrew University, has devoted a lot of effort to the question of what constitutes an explanatory proof. Mathematicians often say about some proof, well, that's clever, but it doesn't really explain it to me. But of course, different people mean different things by what's explanatory. It's partially on the basis of what your previous knowledge and experience is, what you want it to be related to.
Is the study of links different from the study of knots, or is link studying sort of a subset of knot theory?
Well, I would say, rather than a subset, I would say it's a generalization of it, because it includes knots, because the components of links are themselves knots. So knot theory is really a subset of link theory, in fact. And by the way, here I've been talking about what mathematicians call classical knots or classical links, which are knots and links inside of three-dimensional space, the usual representation of physical space that we imagine. Mathematicians, topologists more specifically, actually study knots and links in higher dimensional spaces as well. And there is a large theory of knots in higher dimensional spaces as well. And I'm sort of an expert on that, among other things. So it's a very pretty subject. And it goes back to the 1920s. A great algebraist, Emil Artin, was the first one to construct knots in higher dimensional spaces. He did it by knots here, as we observed, were in three-dimensional space, were formed by a circle. And what he did was he imagined you take a string, say a knotted piece of string like that with an end, and then you twirl it through the fourth dimension. And as you spin it around in the fourth dimension, it spins around and creates a two-dimensional sphere, sort of like twirling it like that. It'll spin out to form a two-dimensional sphere, which will be knotted in four-dimensional space. You can that way get spun knots, which are not circles in four-dimensional space, but two-dimensional spheres, like the surface of a balloon in four-dimensional space. Circles in four-dimensional space always are not. Why is that? Well, because if you had a circle kind of in four-dimensional, well, let's take, for example, the trefoil. Here, in three-dimensional space, you can't unknot this because you've got stuck with these over and under crossings that you can't get rid of. But if you had another dimension of room, you could lift this up, take it around it in the other dimension, and reverse which is under and which is over. And if you can reverse which is under and which is over, you could unknot anything. So circles in four or higher dimensional spaces automatically always can be unknotted. But you do get an analog of knot theory in four-dimensional space, consisting of two-dimensional spheres, which can be knotted up in four-dimensional spaces, and so on. So there's a knot theory in every dimension going up, actually, all of which modern topology does study, in fact, and gets invariants for, polynomial invariants, other invariants. Some of the invariants we're talking about persist the higher dimensions. Sometimes you need other invariants. Some of the invariants work only in dimension 3. It's a fascinating world.